Good morning. My name is Dr. Harneet Kadia. I'm a third year PG resident in Maharishi Markandeshwar Institute of Medical Sciences and Research, Mulana. The topic of my paper is role of diffusion-weighted MRI in musculoskeletal infections. Now, we all know that musculoskeletal imaging is an important diagnostic and teaching tool for the healthcare providers in treatment of MSK pathologies. Now, MSK infections can broadly be divided into the two types of infections, that are superficial lesions, which includes tenosynovitis, cellulitis, and bursitis, and the deep lesions, which include pyomyositis, necrotizing fasciitis, septic arthritis, osteitis, and osteomyelitis. Now, what is the role of diffusion-weighted imaging in these MSK infections? Now, diffusion-weighted imaging is a part of a functional MR imaging, which can be incorporated into the routine non-contrast material, non-contrast enhanced MR imaging. Now, diffusion-weighted imaging, the advantage is that it does not require the additional timing as is required in the contrast imaging. So, it can be easily added into the routine sequences. Now, diffusion-weighted imaging is based on the Brownian motion of the water molecules caused by the tissue's microstructures. Now, the apparent diffusion coefficient is a quantitative measure of this Brownian movement. Low ADC value typically reflects the highly cellular microenvironments in which the diffusion is restricted by the presence of the cell membranes, whereas acellular regions allow free diffusion and results in elevated ADC values. Thus, with ADC mapping, one may derive useful quantitative information regarding the cellularity of our musculoskeletal lesions using a non-enhanced technique. The principle is highly holds true in case of a highly cellular tumor such as the lymphomas and other hybrid malignancies. Contrary to this, in case of the abscesses, the restricted diffusion in the central necrotic area is due to the high viscosity pus, bacteria, and other proteinaceous materials which are present there. Now, the bone has normally both the red and the yellow bone marrow with a significant amount of fat, which is responsible for the high signal intensity on the MR images. Thus, the increased signal we see in the bone is not because of the diffusion restriction, but enhancement of diffusion related to inflammatory edema and because of the cellularity. This enhancement in bone varies according to the pathology, that is either because of the reactive edema, osteomyelitis, intraosseous abscesses, necrotic bones, with the highest signal obtained in case of the intraosseous abscess and least in case of the sequestrum. Now, these are the list of some of the ADC values which are obtained in spectrum of the musculoskeletal infections. For osteomyelitis, the value ranges from 1.1 to 1.4. For the soft tissue abscesses and for the intraosseous abscess, the ADC value corresponds to 0.6 to 1.1. For the pyomyositis and the soft tissue edema, the values are slightly higher than that of the abscess values. That is from the 2 to 3 for the edema and from the pyomyositis 1.5 to 1.8. Now, aims and objective of our study was to study the role of diffusion-weighted imaging in MSK infections and to correlate the MRI and DWI findings with the clinical outcome and clinical diagnosis. The study was carried out in the Department of Radio Diagnosis of Maharishi Markandeshwar Institute of Medical Sciences and Research, Mulana Ambala, and the sample size was 50 patients. Now, the MRI scans were performed with a 1.5 Tesla MR machine, Activa by Philips Medical System. Now, other relevant investigations were taken whenever required, such as the scanograms of the chest x-ray, whenever there was a need for the x-rays. Now, DWI images were obtained in the axial plane at 3 to 4 mm slice thickness, 1 mm intersection gap, and the diffusion sensitizing gradient were applied in all the three orthogonal planes, that is x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, using the b-values ranging from 0 to 800. ADC maps are automatically calculated by the MRI machine software and were included in the sequence. Whenever required, additional sequences were used, like the T1 weighted images with or without fat suppressions, and contrast was also used. The MR findings and the diffusion weighted findings were correlated with the clinical findings and clinical outcome or the operative or the FNA findings. Now, coming to the discussion, diagnosis of the skeletal infection remains a challenge, particularly when it's in the very early stages of the infection. Now, the x-rays cannot rule out the very early stages of infection, so we can use the CT, CINT, and MR are often performed to arrive at the diagnosis in the early cases of the infection. Now, MR is extremely sensitive and gives us the accurate map of the anatomical distribution of the infection. So on MRI, the infected bone marrow gives a low signal on T1 weighted images and high signal on the flare and the T2 weighted images. Now, intramedullary abscess and necrotic area show rim enhancement. Reactive bone marrow edema may also have some bone marrow findings. Diffusion weighted imaging shows normal bone as a dark signal with excellent negative predictive value. Thus, it helps to differentiate the reactive edema from the osteomyelitis. The pus related to intraosseous abscess formation in osteomyelitis will have a greater bone diffusion with the relative restriction, with the ADC value corresponding to 0.6 to 1.1 mm. On the other hand, the reactive bone marrow edema will show mild diffusion with an imaging signal enhancement with increased ADC value. Now, the necrotic bone, sequestrum, air, and devitalized tissue will not show any diffusion restriction, and the corresponding ADC values will be high, while the ischemic but not the dead bone will show the increased diffusion weighted images and lower ADC value. This it can help differentiate between the active infection and the necrotic bone and the ischemic bone, which cannot be otherwise differentiated. Now, MRM staging imaging of the acute osteomyelitis also utilizes the same sequences, Pinnacle T1 and T2 weighted images, TUR and T2 facet images. The findings in the acute osteomyelitis are outcome of medullary space edema and exudate formation. The cases of acute osteomyelitis, the ADC value ranges between the 1.44, and it gives a low signal on T2 weighted images and high signal on T2 and STIR images. In our study, the case of chronic osteomyelitis gives a low to intermediate signal on both the T1 as well as T2 and STIR images. Thus, it was concluded in the study that the differentiation of chronic active from chronic inactive osteomyelitis is quite problematic. In active disease, there is presence of sequestrum, abscess, cloaca, and some periosteal fluid collection. Now, septic arthritis is a complex joint fluid which displays the intermediate or heterogeneous signal on T1 and T2 weighted images with synovial thickening, as well as perisynovial edema. The non-infectious inflammatory synovitis may have similar findings on routine MR sequences. However, DWI can help differentiate the septic arthritis from other entities, as the purulent and pus-like intraarticular fluid will show the restricted diffusion and a lower ADC value. However, early stages of pyogenic arthritis may not show very low ADC values in the joint fluid because of minimal changes in the inflammatory cellular component and the viscosities. Conversely, in some cases, underlying disease such as the RA or OA may have increased protein content and inflammatory cellular density and can cause the restricted diffusion. Now, it may also play some role in differentiating septic arthritis from transient synovitis in pediatric patients. The case of infective arthritis in our study had an average ADC value ranging from 1.7 and gives a low signal on T1 and heterogeneous to high signal on T2 weighted images. In case of the abscess, they have a low signal on T1 weighted images, high signal on T2 and STIR images. MR imaging is excellent not only in demonstrating the abscess but also to demonstrate the extent of involvement of the surrounding tissue. Abscess cavity demonstrates a low signal on T1 weighted images, high signal on T2 weighted images with enhancement of the walls after the contrast administrations. The walls are typically irregular and thick in acute infections, regular, thin and low signal on all the sequences with chronicity. Now, in appropriate clinical findings, these features are fairly specific for diagnosis of the abscess. However, some necrotic tumors may have similar imaging findings. By demonstrating the restricted diffusion in the center of abscess, DWI helps in differentiating these two entities. Conversely, a tumor will show restricted diffusion in the walls as a result of high cellularity. So the cases of intraosseous abscess in our study had the ADC value is the same as that in the Kumar in their study, that is between 0.6 to 1.1. Although cellulitis is a clinical finding, MR is usually obtained to define the extent of the infections and to detect any underlying abscess. Thus, that needs to be drained. On MR, the cellulitis appears skin thickening that has a low signal intensity on T1 weighted images and high signal intensity on STIR and T2 facet T2 weighted images. In situations where contrast cannot be administered, like in case of the RFTs are deranged or the patient is not very cooperative, it may take a long time. The differentiation of cellulitis from the subcutaneous edema can be very difficult. So DWI can be helpful in demonstrating some restriction of the diffusion in cellulitis, while simple subcutaneous edema with increased diffusion. Now, in case of tubercular arthritis, radiographs demonstrate soft tissue swelling, periarticular osteopenia, and interstitial subarticulomatous. The joint space may be normal, wide, or narrow depending on the stage. Unlike pyogenic arthritis, articular cartilage destruction is minimal in early diseases. In the delayed stages, articular destruction leads to reduced joint space, ankle losses. In MR, the soft tissue changes such as synovitis, joint effusion, bursitis, tenosynovitis can better be demonstrated than the radiographs. And periarticular bone marrow edema can also be seen in the MR, which is not seen on the radiograph. The tubercular case gives a low signal intensity on T2 weighted image and a hyper intense signal on T2 weighted images, with few of the cases associated with the joint diffusion. In case of infectious tenosynovitis, DWI may help differentiate the infectious tenosynovitis from non-infectious causes by demonstrating a restricted diffusion due to viscous nature of the fluid or pus in the tendon sheath and the adjacent cellulitis. The fluid in the tendon sheath in infectious tenosynovitis will be seen as a bright area on DWI, dark area on ADC mapping. Tendon tear erosions are also nicely identified with brighter signal alteration on DWI images. Now, other helpful findings from the study demonstrate the difference between the cellulitis and the subcutaneous edema. DWI can also help to differentiate muscle edema and a hematoma, causes T2 shine through and susceptibility artifacts. In our study, we found that finding lesions on DWI and correlation with ADC map and conventional image can play a vital role in diagnosing MSK infection and can supplement the MR imaging in making the final diagnosis. Now, this is an image of obtained. There is a figure A shows a star image. Figure B, there is an axial post contrast patch at T1 images. Now figure C and D corresponds to diffusion weighted images and the ADC images. Now in the figure E, we can see that there is large amount of joint diffusion is or new diffusion is present, and there is a synovial thickening and enhancement after the contrast enhancement. Now the same area which was showing the enhancement can also be under fluid where I seem to restrict on the DWI images, and the corresponding the synovial thickening which is showing the enhancement is seen to restrict on the DWI images and the corresponding low signal on the ADC mapping. So the ADC value corresponds to 1.7 into 10.3, consistent with the clinical suspicion of the septic arthritis. So we can see that the diffusion has almost the same finding as that after the contrast enhancement. Now this is a curve which is showing the diffusion weighted imaging, number of diffusion weighted imaging findings in our study, which corresponds to 84% of the patients which appears hyper on the diffusion weighted imaging. Now this is the corresponding ADC mapping, 84% of the were showing the hypointense signal on the ADC mapping. Now this graph corresponds to range of the ADC values, which were mostly they were corresponds to the low ADC value. Maximum values were between the 1.6 to 2, and almost less than 2 values were there. Now these are the DWI findings, which were appearing hyper intense. Most of them cases include the acute osteomyelitis, non-tubercular hip arthritis, sacroiliitis, tenosynovitis with cellulitis, myositis, all the infectious conditions were appearing hyper on the DWI images, with corresponding their ADC mapping, which were appearing hypo intense on the ADC imaging. Now this is the average ADC value of the infections which were observed. Now in our study suggested that DWI supplements the conventional MR imaging in the area of musculoskeletal infections and act as a problem solving tool in increasing lesions conspicuity and help in differentiating among different but closely related entities, and this helps in their accurate characterization. The knowledge of the aforementioned imaging findings with proper clinical history may help ensure proper diagnosis and thus helps in the proper treatment. Thank you so much.